So welcome today for this episode of The Vote. I'm joined here by Joe Miller, Councillor Joe Miller, who's a Conservative Councillor for the Rottingdean Coastal Ward. You're also on various committees on Brighton Council, including the Audit Committee. I think that's where we're going to start off, because it's quite a busy time for you with the draft budget that was published just before Christmas. What are your initial thoughts on the budget?
My initial thoughts are there's some good stuff there. You've got sort of protection of some key services, but not protection of other sort of key services delivery. I think there's always scope to look more inventively at the budget and how we allocate resources or slice, you know, cut the cake. The cake is so big, it's how you choose to cut it. And I think the administration have made some choices as to how they cut it. They're not focusing enough on savings or earning income from our assets, for example, enough. And that's taken some time for the opposition parties to drive and sort of drive that ourselves in order to get more into the budget so that there's a bigger cake to slice, so you don't have to make the reductions which are proposed, some of which are quite drastic and have been drastic in the past, like to sexual health services, for example, and a number of sort of service delivery, which really does have a key sort of a very severe impact for those users of that service, and also in prevention of public health and for those victims of domestic violence and things like that. So there's a number of areas which I think need to be focused on in order to make the budget right this year.
And what were those cuts to do with sexual health services? Well, I think they were to do HIV prevention, I seem to recall.
There was a very large reduction last year in sexual health services, from about 4.9 million to 4.3 million. So £600,000 was cut from that budget, which in my view was wrong at the time. And I did raise it. There wasn't enough money last year because there were other priorities. So it's a less bad budget than last year, but it's still bad in that element. And so it might be, and there's a proposal to reduce another 100,000 this year. And that basically means that sexual health services across the city are closing. You've got the Brighton walk-in centre, the CCG are reducing the sexual health service there. So we've got a reducing supply of sexual health appointments in the city and a growing demand, as you'd expect. And so there is an issue about capacity there, and you've got like Morley Street's changing its time from 9 o'clock to 10:30, opening a number of closure of particular specialist clinics, like the Claude Nicol Centre at Brighton Sussex University Hospital, at the Royal County. So there is a reduction in the service being offered, and it's about making sure your vacant posts being held open, about making sure that there's capacity so that people can ring up and the phone's answered and they can get an appointment, for example.
So will you be calling for some of that funding to be reinstated into the revised budget proposal, or what does
I think that's up to the administration as to what they decide to do in their revision of the budget. We will look at the budget proposal when it is fully established and final, and see what the position is there. I mean, the government have made a number of steps as a result of the local government settlement to enable the council to have more funding. For example, there was a proposal which was factored into the original budget to change new homes bonus, which would have about a £450,000 reduction to the council budget. That has not happened in the final settlement. So there's £450,000 extra, but then there's a number of moving parts constantly as the budget is agreed and come to a sort of a final conclusion. And so we will look at it when it comes and see what the proposals are, see what the impact is for our residents and for the members of the public in our city, and what has the most severe impact we'll try and put some amendments to avoid.
Okay, and staying with the budget, I mean, obviously you're supportive of the proposals to keep funding for looked after children and for adult social care. I think there's a general consensus at council that's the right approach, that those areas should be protected.
I think that's right. I think, you know, sort of looking after elderly and young people that are most vulnerable is essential, and it's right that those services are protected as well as others. The council can be more inventive to raise more money or to make back of house savings or office, you know, so there is a lot of There's still some fat to trim, I think, and when you're cutting frontline services and the fat hasn't been trimmed, I have a slight issue. So it's about making sure those are the right choices.
What are the next steps for the budget then, in terms of council and what happens at council and then in the committee that you chair? What can we expect in the next weeks?
So the budget just will go to Policy, Resources and Growth Committee. There'll be, a revised budget proposal, and then it will come to full council, budget council, for decision, agreement, any amendments. The committee I chair doesn't have much influence over the budget as such. It signs off the statement of accounts, which is the financial year after the actual budget has been delivered. But the committee, Audit and Standards Committee, has two functions, really. It has the standards function when there's a member complaint, a complaint about a member, should I say, from a councillor or a member of the public, and independent persons and the monitoring officer review that to make sure the seven principles of public life are upheld, and our code of conduct and social media proposal and councillor officer code of conduct, the relationship between those are all upheld in the appropriate manner. And if that isn't agreed, or an apology, or there isn't agreement between the complainant and the councillor, then it would end up going to a standards panel, which happens very rarely. The other function is the audit function, which one of the element is the sort of scrutiny of council decisions, because we don't have a scrutiny committee anymore, so it's becoming more having that role in making sure the council's right. It's about keeping an eye on our strategic risks as an organisation. Audit in private organisations has a very key component on a company's board, for example, and sits very close. So companies are quite risk averse. That's generally how they run their organisations, yeah. Whereas councils aren't. So it's about promoting audit in that way and making sure that we look at our strategic risks. So implications such as Grenfell Tower don't happen. So there's a wide range of risks, whether it be public health issues as a result of those sexual health reductions, or it could be the council meeting its financial challenges, or, you know.
Okay. Just staying with the budget, with the council tax increase, does the Conservative group have a position that, obviously, we've seen a lot of rises in council tax over recent years. This is, again, at the threshold before you need to call a local referendum. I think it's 2.99%. Do you have a view on that? Are you going to support that? Do you know yet in council?
Well,
and secondly, how long do you think we can have council tax increases for? Do you think this is going to be like a yearly occurrence, or do you think they'll be frozen at some point?
Well, there's the adult social care precept as well as the council tax. So there's two elements to it. Adult social care, I think, is very important. I think everyone recognises that more money needs to go in the adult social care sector. I'm not adverse to tax increases. As per se, I don't think I have an issue when there's a lot of, you know, when an organisation isn't running as efficiently as it possibly could be, or there's no drive to make that efficient. Why should we tax to subsidise an inefficient organisation? Not saying the council is inefficient. I'm just saying it shouldn't. General principle, you know, there will always be some inefficiency, but as efficient as possible. I don't have a strict view. The final proposal hasn't come, so it's very difficult to say exactly, you know, what the council tax level is likely to be. It is likely to be the higher amount. Lots of Conservative councils do support the higher level of council tax. My issue is that sometimes we have got protection for those on low pay and unemployed to ensure that they aren't hit by rising council. But I also think the working people who struggle, maybe it hits them as well, and so I think it's about making sure that the rise in council tax aren't outstripped by increases in pay. So if the council tax is below inflation or level of pay inflation, then I'm not so adverse, because pay is keeping up with levels of tax increases. Otherwise you're taking money away from those who need it most.
Do you think they're here to stay then, annual council tax rises? Because obviously there are some councils, Wandsworth in London's one of them, where they have frozen it, I think, for a number of years. I'm not sure what situation is now, but I know in the past it's been frozen. But you don't see that happening in the Brighton Council?
Well, Wandsworth's particularly interesting council. They're very efficiently run, and their council tax is like half of that to the you know, it's two sides of the street. One is half of that of the, than the other side. One Conservative run, one Labour run. So it's quite interesting. So there is efficiency. I think it, you know, tax-wise, tax shouldn't be increased just because we can increase it. It should be for a need or to provide more services or whatever. But I don't think that we should get to level where the state, you know, we have astronomical levels of tax. I think probably 30 to 35% tax of GDP is about right. I think we're about 37% currently, so I think it probably could come down a little bit, but not massively. The second point of your question was in relation to whether Brighton and Hove City Council would increase council tax. I imagine they would, because you've got the Green Party and the Labour Party on the council, which currently hold, I think, about 34 members between them, which is a majority, and they're generally pro-tax increase.
Okay, Joe, that's it for the first half. Join us in the second half, where we're going to be talking about Joe's Rottingdean Coastal Ward in a bit more detail. So welcome back to today's vote. I'm speaking to Councillor Joe Miller, who's a Rottingdean Council ward member, Conservative member. Joe, tell us a bit about your ward. It stretches quite a long way along Brighton, doesn't it?
Yeah, so it's the biggest ward geographically, actually. It has quite a number of sort of separate populations. It's got Saltdean up to Longreader Avenue, Ovingdean, Rottingdean, the Marina, which is quite an interesting place, Blackrock, which is quite an interesting development site, Rodine, the Arundels and Sussex Square and Lewis Crescent as well.
Yeah, and that's quite a diverse... There's a lot of different needs there, isn't there, in Rottingdean's kind of its own distinct area.
Yeah.
But then you've got, as you say, Blackrock, you've got the Brighton Marina, which is a major development, so it must be keeping you busy. What are your major projects at the moment? What are your main campaigns and what are you working on?
So... a number of things across the ward. If we were to start in Saltdean, there's the main issue for Saltdean is Saltdean Lido and keep making sure, so the pool's being restored, but it's making sure that the listed building is restored and the pool then becomes available 24 years round, and sort of keeping, basically shouting across the ward that we are here, and you know, we're further out of the city, but there's lots going on. The other thing, if we move across to Rottingdean, about the high street and the air quality area, and there's and some issues around that and sort of proposals to improve the public realm. Ovingdean generally is quite okay, but development is an issue in Ovingdean. There's some transport implications, transport issues on Falmer Road and through Ovingdean. Speeding traffic is particular, especially on Falmer Road outside Long Hill High School, where the school I'm a governor at, which just got a good in their Ofsted. There's some issues about sort of how people access the bus stops on the other side of the road, and that's a campaign. And then development of all across those sort of three conurbations is key, because there's green fields between the current development and the South Downs National Park, which the council has allocated some housing to, and so there's a number of planning applications coming forward, like St Albans or Coombe Farm or Falmer Avenue or Meadowvale, which has been granted appeal. It's making sure that they're the right developments, appropriate developments for those locations, if they're appropriate at all. And then you've got places in the ward, like Rodine. There's a number of development issues there. There's parking issues, and in Sussex Square, sort of Lewis Crescent and the Arundels and the Marina, there's issues around Blackrock development, making sure that's not too high. The development, the Marina isn't so high, you know, isn't too high. You know, so there's concerns from residents about that, and it's about making sure that the sites that are available, like the Gasworks and the Blackrock, are developed, because they're appropriate brownfield sites for development, and you want regeneration in those areas and the Marina. Whereas sort of making sure that sites which are less appropriate are sort of looked at more carefully.
So it's fair to say planning comes quite high up on your agenda when you're dealing with constituency work in your ward. So what are the major developments? I mean, Brighton Marina They've already built one of the new proposed blocks of flats. How do you see the further development of Brighton Marina? How do you see that going?
Yeah, so planning and transport are the key issues. I've outlined a number of developments in other areas of the ward, but the Marina and Blackrock, I think, are key sort of in the city plan for the city, actually, and what it can deliver for the city. It's not just 40 houses. It's, you know, there's over 1,000 houses allocated, 2,000, you know, where actually the capacity for the Marina is probably, the council's looking to put a lot more than that in there. The current proposals, there's, I suppose, a long history to the development of the Marina. Some of it's been built out, as you say. As the Outer Harbour development, where they're building on the sea, is interesting in that the scheme, phase one has been delivered, but there's been, as I understand it, there's been a sale of that piece of land, and the current developers are looking to build a different, put in different planning permission than the old scheme. So the old scheme's been, the later phase of the old scheme's been pulled, and it's making sure that that is maximising development, and he's going to contribute to the regeneration of the Marina and the public realm around it, and make it not just a sort of, if you're building 1,000 homes or potentially or a hotel or office space in the Marina, making it sure it's a place which is lived and used and feels nice to live in year round and attracts people to the Marina, including transport implications from Madeira Drive, and making access into the Marina a lot easier.
Because I always feel living near Brighton Marina that there could be easier ways for people, for particularly tourists, to access it. I mean, obviously we've got the number 7 bus, which is great, but I always thought a rapid transport system between the centre of Brighton and Brighton Marina would be a really good idea. Do you ever see that coming off the ground? Because it's been spoken of before. Do you see it happen?
Well, it would require a large amount of investment. I suppose you've got the issue is, where do you put it? You've got the Volks Railway and you've got Madeira Terrace. I think the key to making the Marina is, as it said, we need to develop the Blackrock, and that development with Standard Life and Churchill Square extending under the Brighton Centre and building another Brighton Centre is essential to draw people along. It's essential that we have the Outer Harbour development, and then we also look to the Inner Harbour development, where David Lloyd and McDonald's and the Bowlplex and Rendezvous Casino is, and the car park, and then to Asda potentially. Slightly more difficult with Asda because of their lease. And then how you access into the Marina from Madeira Terrace, I think Madeira Drive is particularly important. So you've got all those three chunks of development which need to happen, and there needs to be a master plan really about how this happens, because piecemeal development, you end up with a scheme which doesn't look particularly nice, public realm which doesn't look particularly nice, no one wants to be in, but also really bad access as a result of that. And so it's about siting the Brighton Centre on the Blackrock site correctly, and also about having those transport links along, and having pit stops along, because you have a nice summer evening, people would walk from the pier. I know it's about half an hour. It's longer than you think, or they might use a Brighton bike. But it's about having, if you develop Madeira Terraces and make that a nicer part, and when Madeira Terraces end from there to sort of Duke's Mound, and then Black Rock a nicer walk, and things to look at. There are current things, but Peter Pan's, something needs to happen now. That's not going to happen. The swimming pool. To encourage people to walk along there, cycle along there, and it's about also linking this to the Valley Gardens scheme and having some kind of rapid transport system as part of that proposal to get people to and from the new Brighton Centre, because that's going to be key. You're going to have 10,000 people leaving a concert arena that need to get back to Brighton Station. How are you going to do it?
That's what I had in mind when I mentioned it. But what's going on at Blackrock then? What exactly is, because has that got approval yet? I think there's been outline planning, is that right, for the new Brighton Centre, or where are we at there? Because that's a really exciting project.
Yeah, I think it's quite a long, there hasn't been any planning. As I understand it, there are drafts of proposals, but they're going to change. The council's just has agreed to sign. I'm not sure if they have signed yet. I think they have signed the conditional land agreement with Standard Life, which is a sort of very complex legal document where you sell X at this point for X amount and Y, and we covered that. It's extremely complicated. And that took a lot longer to agree and to propose, to sort of come up with than we hoped for, which has slowed the development down. And actually, it's likely to sort of be another four or five years before we start seeing spades in the ground. So it's a particularly long process, and the economic cycles can change. So that's the unfortunate thing. But Brighton is booming and it's becoming more like London. And during the recession, London kept on building. So we're hoping that, the same happens there.
Yeah. Great. Moving along the coast. So we've got Saltdean. I think there's planning issues around Saltdean that you've been dealing with in the past as well, because that's an area, you know, is getting more built up and it's becoming much more popular. It always was a popular area, but I think a lot of people want to live in Saltdean, don't they? And so that's why you're getting probably more proposals for house building and bungalow building, flat building.
We have to build more housing in the city. The difficulty is we're stuck between the sea and the downs, and so we looked at brownfield sites and a few urban fringe sites, which are not always the most appropriate sites to develop first, in my opinion. But you've got the there are a number of sites in Saltdean which have come up or have got agreed planning permission, some of which are inappropriate in my opinion. But we have to build houses for young people to be able to buy and to be able to rent and people to downsize to, so that people then go into the bigger family homes. But there is a bit of a demographic shift across the city where you've got DFLs down from London's coming in, inflating the central Brighton property market because they're selling their properties in London for £1 or 2 million for a three bedroom terrace, and they can get one here for £600,000 or £700,000 in quite a nice, you know, sort of very popular area. And so that's then encouraging other people to move out further east and west to sort of Shoreham and New Haven, Seaford, Peace, even including, and part of that is Saltdean because the property is cheaper in seems to be cheaper in Saltdean. You get more for your money, and a nicer garden, cleaner air, nice views, nice dog walks, good pubs.
What's not to like? Okay, Joe, thanks for coming in today for the vote, and all the best for the coming year.
Thank you very much.
Thanks. The Brighton